In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. The Lord be with you. My brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do. Through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask, Blessed Mary, Ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Gloria in excelsis Deo. Almighty ever-living God, constantly accomplish the paschal mystery within us, that those you were pleased to make new in holy baptism may, under your protective care, bear much fruit and come to the joys of life eternal. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. As the number of disciples continued to grow, the Hellenists complained against the Hebrews because their widows were being neglected in the daily distribution. So the 12 called together the community of the disciples and said, "It is not right for us to neglect the word of God to serve at table. Brothers, select from among you seven reputable men filled with the Spirit and wisdom, whom we shall appoint to this task, whereas we shall devote ourselves to prayer and to the ministry of the word." The proposal was acceptable to the whole community, so they chose Stephen, a man filled with faith and the Holy Spirit, also Philip, Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, and Parmenas, and Nicholas of Antioch, and a convert to Judaism. They presented these men to the apostles, who prayed and laid hands on them. The word of God continued to spread, and the numbers of the disciples in Jerusalem increased greatly. Even a large group of priests were becoming obedient to the faith. The word of the Lord. A reading from the letter of St. Peter. Beloved, come to him, a living stone, rejected by human beings, but chosen and precious in the sight of God. And like living stones, let yourselves be built into a spiritual house, to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices, acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For it says in Scripture, "Behold, I am laying a stone in Zion, a cornerstone, chosen and precious, and whoever believes in it shall not be put to shame. Therefore, its value is for you who have faith, but for those who, without faith, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone, and a stone that will make people stumble, and a rock that will make them fall. They stumble by disobeying the word, as is their destiny. You are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people of his own, so that you may announce the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You have faith in God, have faith also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If there were not, would I have told you that I am going to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back again and take you to myself, so that where I am, you also may be. Where I am going, you know the way." Thomas said to him, "Master, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, then you will also know my Father. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." Philip said to him, "Master, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us." Jesus said to him, "Have I been with you for so long a time, and you still do not know me, Philip? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? The words that I speak to you, I do not speak on my own. The Father who dwells in me is doing his works. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father is in me, or else believe because of the works themselves. Amen, amen, I say to you, whoever believes in me will do the works that I do, and will do greater ones than these, because I am going to the Father." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. First, to the mothers who are joining us in the prayer of this Mass today, a happy Mother's Day and an assurance of our prayers here at the seminary for you and thanksgiving for your maternal charity, and asking our Blessed Mother in particular to watch over you, protect you, and help you to have all the grace that you need to live a life pleasing to her Son and to our Savior. Today is the fifth Sunday of Easter, and it will be the last Mass that we will offer to you via this way of sharing the grace of the altar. The men from the seminary complete their semester and will be departing soon. And please know of our continued prayers for you and for your families. And we are grateful also for your prayers for us, especially for the men in formation, for the Diocese of Bridgeport, and if I could ask you, as the priest responsible for them, to continue to pray for them and pray for vocations to the priesthood for our diocese, and of course for yours as well. Now, one of the great themes of human history is the struggle between freedom and slavery. We can think of that struggle, freedom versus slavery, in the civil or the social sense. One group has enslaved another. We know this from the story of secular history, from history books with which we are familiar from our school days, but we also know it from scriptural history. We know the story of the chosen people in the Old Testament. We know that at various times how they were oppressed by the Egyptians, by the Assyrians, by the Babylonians, by the Philistines.
So this idea of freedom and slavery is one that we understand as students of secular and scriptural history. And all of the occasions where one person or a group of people are enslaved by another is, of course, a grave tragedy. And that tragedy, which is the collective oppression of a people, follows from something else, something that precedes it. In other words, what is vast and widespread begins with something that is personal and that is multiplied in many hearts. Our Lord says, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. So here I am not claiming that everyone who develops the habit of sinful behavior perceives that it is a form of slavery. We know that that is not the case. I'm only claiming that Jesus sees things this way. And as his disciples, we are to put on his mind, as St. Paul encourages us to put on the mind of Christ. So when we think about the struggle between slavery and freedom, let's keep or make it personal in the way that Jesus did. In fact, it was very personal to Christ because he suffered the effects of sin on Good Friday without himself ever giving himself over to sin, without ever having committed one. Now, within your heart and my heart lies a longing for deliverance, for freedom from some active force of decay, some poison from which I cannot liberate myself. What we consider the crimes against humanity, in whatever form they are, and the oppression of people that suffer as a result, that manifests this principle of decay, disorder that is first within the human heart or soul. That's why St. Paul can write very humbly in the letter to the Romans, "The good that I want to do, I don't do. And the evil that I want to avoid, that is what I do." In the letter to the Galatians, St. Paul says, "For freedom Christ has set us free." And he was able to make this claim, of course, because he knew his own heart. And he had the courage and the simplicity to admit the problem, as well as the faith to accept and understand the remedy. Paul knew that the turmoil, the evil that we see in civil society, in history, begins here, in immoral conduct. You and I call this, or these things, the seven deadly sins: pride, avarice, lust, envy, gluttony, anger, and sloth. Egypt and Babylon were places of captivity for God's chosen people because the oppressing of God's people began when others were given over to those sins in their own lives. And so it has been throughout human and salvation history. Now, for us as disciples of Christ, sin is not just immoral or unethical behavior. It is that, of course. It is that in some measure, but it is also, from our point of view, a slavery to a spiritual evil, where I willingly give over power over my soul to something that is contrary to my humanity, the seven deadly sins. And so, in whatever degree I give myself over to sin, even if it's just in the moment, I forfeit, in some measure, my freedom, my dignity, my peace, my happiness. Whoever commits sin, Jesus said, is a slave to sin. And the wages of sin are death, as St. Paul said, and he is speaking there of spiritual death. And even before that death, the wages of sin are fear, anxiety, sadness, and a lack of peace. Let's take the sin of envy, for instance. Envy is that sadness or discontent at the excellence, good fortune, or success of another that I choose to feel. I consider myself deprived. Some injustice has been done to me, I think, and so I resent it. This illustrates what we have been considering, how I make myself a moral or spiritual prisoner to a disordered desire. And as a result, my humanity is diminished because some part of me is controlled or enslaved. Jesus told us, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. In describing sin, St. Thomas Aquinas said that we do not offend God except insofar as we harm ourselves by doing something contrary to our own good. We harm ourselves when we commit sin, and therefore we offend God because we are doing something that hurts Him, that hurt Jesus on the cross. It explains why God hates sin, because it damages or can even destroy the thing that He loves the most and for which His Son gave His life, you and me. In the second reading for today, St. Peter describes us as a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people of God's own, so that we may announce the praises of Him who called us out of darkness and into a wonderful light. This is the gift of Christ, dear people, that He has called us to Himself and now and given to us the desire to announce the good news. And that good news is that Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. The way, the truth, and the life of individual souls, and therefore of the common good. We recognize that there are many social ills in our society, and certainly at this time there is much uncertainty and unrest. But the freshness of the gospel message and the power of the risen Christ, the grace of the sacraments, a life of prayer, charity, and self-forgetfulness, the communion of believers who are of one mind and heart, these gifts, dear people, are ours, and they continue to mark out and safeguard human freedom and the flourishing of the human soul, and they protect us from the danger of the seven deadly sins. The grace of Christ gives us the power to grow in the opposite virtues: humility, liberality or generosity, chastity, meekness, temperance, brotherly love, and diligence. We admire these qualities when we see them in others because we are made for them ourselves. And those great gifts of God, those virtues that are made possible by the life of Christ, when we live those virtues for the love of God and for His image in others, then we share in the freedom and the joy of the risen Christ, whose gift to us is new life today. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.
True God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through Him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, He came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake He was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and His kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We offer our prayers and petitions to our gracious, generous, and loving Father in heaven.
for Pope Francis, Bishop Caggiano, and all the shepherds of our souls, that they may have the strength to govern wisely the flock entrusted to them by Christ the Good Shepherd. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who are joining us from home, that their faith in Christ, the Son of God, who is the way, the truth, and the life, may grow more fervent. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all mothers, on this Mother's Day, that following the example of our Blessed Mother, they may always be close to Christ and lead their families to Him. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick, especially from COVID-19, that they may recognize the presence of Christ with them, who redeemed all suffering on the cross, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the dead, especially from COVID-19, that they may be raised up and eternally dwell in the place prepared for them by Christ, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Almighty and merciful Father, we place these prayers and petitions of those that we hold in the silence of our hearts at the foot of your heavenly throne, confident that if they be in accordance with your divine will for us, you will grant them through Christ our Lord.
Sing a song in honor of this day. Come and hear
pray, brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father. O God, who by this wonderful exchange effected in this sacrifice have made us partakers of the one supreme Godhead, grant, we pray, that as we have come to know your truth, we may make it ours by a worthy way of life, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but in this time above all to laud you yet more gloriously, when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. For he is the true Lamb who has taken away the sins of the world. By dying he has destroyed our death, and by rising restored our life. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exults in your praise. And even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. To you, therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Frank, our Bishop, and all those who hold him to the truth and on the Catholic and Apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servant. And all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you this sacrifice of praise, for they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls in hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers on all things we may be defended by your protecting help through Christ our Lord. Amen. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family. Order our days in your peace and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen through Christ our Lord. Amen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect, Make it spiritual and acceptable so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands. And with eyes raised to heaven to you, God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Mysterium fidei, mortem tuam annunciamus Domine, et tuam resurrectionem confitemur, Domine venia. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the blessed passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ, your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance and to accept them as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the Just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. Humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high, in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, in all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. To us also, your servants, who though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon. Through Christ our Lord. Through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord, you sanctify them, fill them with light, bless them, and bestow them upon us. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope in the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace in unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
I'm yours.
beata mundi, miserere nobis, agnus Dei, qui tollis peccata mundi, dona nobis pacem. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed. Let us pray. Graciously be present to your people, we pray, O Lord, and lead those you have imbued with heavenly mysteries to pass from former ways to newness of life, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go forth, the Mass is ended. St. Michael the Archangel, defend us in battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all evil spirits who prowl throughout the world seeking the ruin of souls. Amen.
Laetare, alleluia. Quia per meruisti portare.